Jesus speaks to me, and a billow seems to roll, bringing life and health and gladness all around this heavenly guest. Banished unbelief and sadness, change our weariness into rest. Oh, blessed quietness, yes, holy quietness, what assurance in my soul. On the stormy sea, Jesus speaks to me, and a billow seems to roll. Last verse. What a wonderful salvation, where we always see His face. What a perfect habitation, what a quiet resting place. Oh, blessed quietness, blessed quietness,
holy quietness,
holy quietness.
What a sure
rock
in my soul,
down in my soul, on the stormy sea. I know He speaks to me,
and the
billow seems to roll. Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Blessed quietness. But let's don't be too quiet in here this morning. Old saying goes, let's make a little noise.
Yes.
Amen. I thank God for all of you being here on today, and we just pray that God will say something that will enlighten your load, will give you strength to make it through another week. Are you at John chapter 3 yet?
Yes.
Will you stand as we begin at verse number 4 through verse 8? And it begins reading, Nicodemus says unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto thee, ye must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Let us pray. Father God, we stand here now behind this sacred desk. God, I ask for a fresh anointing from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. Anoint your people, oh God, that they will not only be hearers but doers of your word. Open their hearts and their spirit and their mind that they be recipient of your word. God, we now ask that you hide me behind this desk, that they see less of me and more of you. As I stand on the wall of this gospel, we ask these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I want to talk for just a few minutes and listen carefully, if you will. Take me back to where I first believed. Take me back to where I first believed. And some years ago, Andre Crouch wrote a song that says, take me back to the place that I first received. Many of us, sometimes in our Christian life, forget where we even come from. We start out in an humble beginning. We start out with a true love of our brothers and sisters. We start out with so much God in us that some people don't even recognize us anymore. But as we grow older and we get sort of set in our ways, in the habits of some church congregations, somehow or another, we lose that. We lose that affection that we have for one another. We lose that love that we have for one another. And somehow, I believe that the devil wants us to just go back to where we started from. And I think it'd be the best for us to do if God would take us back to where we first began.
Yes.
Because then we will realize that in a lot of sense, where we first, I'm gonna just bring it up. When we first met our first love, what did we feel when we first saw him or her? We need to go back to that. We need to take a trip back in our minds and our memory and let it capture that feeling, that responsibility that we had back then. We were more humanized. We were more serving each other with humility. We were serving each other with a compassion. But where had that compassion and that humility gone? It seemed to have dissipated over the years, because now that we're sitting in the pew, we think we got it made. Well, I'm here to tell you that you got a target on your back, and the devil wants you back. And all you got to do is say, Lord, take me back. Take my mind back. Let the curtain of memory roll back every now and then, so you can show me where you bought me from.
Yes.
From my humble beginning. God, I remember, before I was able to have 2 pairs of shoes. Mm-hmm. I only had 1 pair. Right. And that pair had cardboard in the sole that called up the hole. Lord, I remember when I didn't have but 1 suit. Yeah. I was humble enough to thank you for that suit. Yeah. But now that I got a closet full, I wake up and I got to go there and just decide on which one I need to wear. Oh God, take my mind back, take my soul back, take my heart back, take my spirit back to where I first received it. Because then I will be able to serve you like I should serve you. But you know, somehow or another, long as we stay in a congregation, we become cold and crusty. We become obnoxious with our ways, because we got to judge everybody by the way we feel they ought to be judged. Ah, let us remember now, even though we have become somewhat adultish and grown upish, we got to remember that we were once that unfounded, uncorralled spirit, done anything that we thought we were big enough to do. We were once like that. So why have we got to judge everybody according to where we are? Why have we got to judge everybody according to our thinking? What we need to understand is that if God had not loved us like he loved us, we wouldn't be where we are today. He's still keeping us for some reason. So every now and then we all say, God, take me back. My mind is just exploding with stuff that the devil has sunk into my spirit. I don't love like I used to, God, but when I first came in here, you showed me compassion. You showed me love. You accepted me with open arms. But now, I know you told Peter that when you are converted, when you are converted, strengthen your brothers. That's what we were supposed to do. But instead of strengthening each other, it seemed like we began to get meaner towards one another. We don't love each other like we did when we first come into the church. We love. We fellowship. We have all of these good time feeling. But it seemed like the longer we stayed in church, the meaner we got. Huh? Do you think God is pleased? No, I don't believe he is. So we had to say, Lord, take me back to where I first believed. Here in the Bible, we find Nicodemus, one of those that didn't want his fellow man to know he was really with Jesus. He wanted those Sanhedrins to understand that I'm with you, but I'm with him also. But I know if I tell you I'm with him, then you're not going to fellowship with me anymore. You're not going to have anything to do with me. We got folk in the church like that. They find out you say, well, you a goody two-shoe. You a holy roller now. I can't talk to you no more. Right. Well, if I got a person full of the Holy Spirit, that is Because then I know they can get a prayer through when I need it. But if I got somebody that's all trusted and rested and don't want to be justified, then I don't need you to try to pray for me. You might pray the wrong prayer. I might get the wrong end or something. But Nicodemus wanted to sneak in and come to Jesus by night. Many of us don't want to be seen as lovers of God. Many of us don't want to be seen as being saved and sanctified and set apart. Many of us rather hide our identity as being Christian. But we need to wake up. We weren't ashamed when we first believed. When God first came into our life. We weren't ashamed to stand up and say, "Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus." But the older and the longer we sat in that pew, we started to peep around to see who's looking, who might criticize me. I say, forget them, because if the morning train comes, if the rapture should happen, I want to be with Jesus. I don't know about you, but they can stay here and live in the turmoil all they want to. But I want to live with Jesus. So I don't have that Nicodemus attitude. Jesus said to him, that verily I say unto you. In other words, truly, truly, I say unto you, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit. Yes. What do you mean, Jesus? Well, flesh is flesh. Mm-hmm. And he said, flesh and blood cannot enter the kingdom of God. Yeah. But your spirit, that which is spirit is spirit. Yeah. Nicodemus was one scholar. He was a genuine teacher of the law. He should have understood what Jesus was saying, but he made it so complicated by saying what he said when he said, how can a man be born again except, and when he's old, that he go in, how can he go into his mother's womb a second time? No, you got it all wrong, Nicodemus. You got it all wrong, church pew sitters. You can't be born again by going back in your mother's womb, even though that was a safe haven. For 9 months you stayed in there, you got fed, you got nurtured, you got everything. That was a safe haven for you. But now that you have out and come into the world, you need Jesus. Yes. The will that can save you from everything. Yes. You need his love and his care. Yes. Yeah, you're out in the world now. Yes. So Lord, take me back. So that I can strengthen my brothers. And Jesus just plainly said, marvel not that I say unto you, must be born again. Marvel not that I tell you, go back to where you started from. You're going to find out that God has something for you. God said, when I started you out, I told you I'd never leave you nor forsake you. God told you what to do, but some of us are so hard-headed and stiff-necked that we don't want to tell our brothers and sisters how our humble beginning, how we started out. Everybody thinks sometimes you see, I know the young men and young lady over there think that some of us, when we tell them something, they think we never done nothing before. Some of us want to act so pious, like we never sinned. But believe me, young men, all of us in here are sinners.
Amen.
Saved by grace.
Thank you, God.
Yeah, I once was lost in sin, but I'm so glad Jesus took me in. He bought me in and took me out of the concrete mud. Set me up on a rock to stay. He wouldn't let my foot slip, even though sometimes I wanted to turn and go back to that old sinful world. Sometimes temptation just overcame me, and I wanted to step back, but somehow he carried me back to when he first bought me in. Somehow he got my mind turned around and told me that look where I bought you from. You could have been dead and gone and sleeping in your grave. But I had to protect you. Didn't I tell you that I would be with you even to the end of the world? Didn't I tell you that I'd never leave you? Didn't I tell you that I always would be by your side? I had to think about it sometime, and I had to turn back. Yeah. There's been some time you feel like giving up. Friends get killed. Parents die. Close relatives get sick. You feel like throwing in the towel. You feel like just saying, Lord, I'm tired of living. This is it. I'm giving up. But he said, no, my child. I'm not through with you yet. Let you know that the candle might be dim, but the light ain't out yet. We got to hang in there. And sometimes God will take us back to let us know that he sent his son Jesus just to die for us. I'm so glad that Jesus explained to this young man that the wind, it blows. It comes and you can't tell where it started. You can't tell where it's going or where it's coming from. So is the Spirit. It's just like that. You don't know where it come from. And you don't know where it's going. Don't let nobody fool you. Every now and then when the devil's put your mind like scrambled eggs, just tell God, take me back to the place when I first received you. Take me back. Set me down and talk to me. Let me know that I'm his own. The devil will try to trick you and fool you. What do you need protection from? You're not here to live forever. Huh? So you better get your house in order. I heard him tell King Hezekiah, get your house in order. Death is going to come knocking on your door. Soon one morning it shall come. Maybe in the morning, maybe at night or noon. I don't know, but it's soon to come. But every now and then you ought to tell God, take me back. Take me back to where I first believed. And I tell you one thing, when he takes you back and you begin to reminisce, then you see the real meaning of how Jesus died. You begin to understand how he passed that everything off and just said, Death, you don't have any instructions for me. I'm here to claim my victory. And in Jesus, he let us know we got the victory. And I'm so glad that he died for me. I don't know about you, but all my sins are forgiven. It doesn't matter what I've done. But he has forgiven me for every sin. Oh, yes, he has. His shed blood is the one that proved it. I don't know, but somebody need to take me and show me how God's chemical laboratory works. How can it take my black soul, run it through some red blood, and I come out white as snow? Somebody please tell me. But the love of God will assure you that one day you won't wind up here in a hell. One day his love will carry you on to a place that is rooted with healing. A place that is rooted with water. A place that will say you won't thirst no more. A place that said you won't hunger anymore. Oh God, take me back and remind me every now and then from where I started from. Take me back, dear Lord, to the place where I first believed. I don't know about you, but God is good. He's good to me. And I know he's good to you too. I'm so glad that he sent his son down, that whosoever believeth on him would not perish but have everlasting life. In this unsure world nowadays, we live in a time when we're just not sure. Some of us don't know where to step out of our house or not. But I tell you, if you have this blessed assurance that Jesus is mine, if you have that blessed assurance that he whispers every now and then, you are my child. And I love you. I love you so much that my son died for you. You are my child. You shouldn't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow is not promised to anyone. But get your house in order. Set everything straight, for today is the day of salvation. I'm so glad that Christ died on the cross. That when he came down, he was dead. But look what happened on the third day morning. After laying in a tomb all night long, he got up early on Sunday morning, had all power in his hand, and he stretched out on God's green earth, said, I have in my hand the keys to life, hell, and the grave. God had given him all power, so why not let him have you? He got all power. That's my subject and my sermon and my word for today. That's the word God gave to me to give to you. Take me back to the place that I first believed. Let me just lecture for just about 5 minutes, and then we're gonna go from here. Some of us have been in a topsy-turvy world so long that we don't know what to believe anymore. We see things on TV, sound good, looks good, but is it good? No. You have these people telling you, well, you read a Bible that was translated by a white man. Yeah, John Wesley was white. He was an Englishman. He was assigned by King James to interpret the Bible because there was self-disobedience in his kingdom. And he said, John Wesley, I want you to interpret it so those people can read for themselves. I want you to interpret the Bible, but you don't have to read, do the whole thing. Yeah, but these 66 books ain't never been wrong.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
John Wesley did translate them. Yeah, he was white.
Yeah.
And it was King James. But if we read the real translation or the real Bible that was written, that it took 1,500 years to write all the scriptures that went into him condensing this. This is a condensed version. These 66 books, they're books that he did not put in here. That's true. But he's got what was necessary. You don't need any more than what's in here to make it in. There's not a lie in this book. You don't need any more than what's in here. Yeah, the Bible was first brought out for civil obedience, but after you read it, it's good for the soul.
Amen.
And one thing that we have found out that in the Bible, the most important word in here is obedience. And I heard you hear my grandmother, and I'm sure most of you have heard it, said obedience is better than sacrifice.
Yeah.
In other words, as long as you obey the word of God, you don't have to worry about nothing. So every now and then, I had to have the Lord to take me back to the place where I first believed. Because if I'd have stayed the way I was, I probably would have been gone. I know I got some witnesses in here. But ain't you glad he changed me? Ain't you glad he changed me? Aren't you glad he came into your life? Aren't you glad he showed you a better way? Huh? We could have been dead and gone. But he made out a golden moment for us. I just thank him.
Thank you, God.
Praise God. Amen. Take me back. Sometimes my mind get away with these worldly things. Have God take me back.
Yes.
Hide me.
Yes.
In your love.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you.
That's the message. And if Kevin had been here, we were going to do Take Me Back by Andre Crouch, but he ain't here.
Yes.
I'm scared I might do the wrong note. So we just going to extend the gospel invitation from here. If there's anyone that want God to just start you out with his love and take you back to where you first believed.
Man.
Because if we remember how it was when we first believed, we felt free, we felt rejuvenated, we felt joy. Am I right about it? Somebody tell me, come on now. Did you feel the joy when you first believed? And you said, and I remember the William brother said, there ain't no high like the Holy Ghost high.
Yes.
Can't nothing, I don't care what's in the drugstore, can't make you no higher than what the Holy Ghost can.
All right.
You don't feel no pain. You don't feel no agony. The Holy Ghost will keep you.
Thank you, God.
Amen. Hallelujah. So if there's one today that wants to come, please come at this time. And we're going to go down from this.